Championship weekend. We're actually recording this a little earlier than we usually do. It's Sunday right now. We're kind of finishing up the afternoon games as we record, but we just weren't going to be able to record on Monday night. But so hopefully, if there's some breaking news that happens on Monday before we release this, don't hold it against us.
Yeah.
But I think what we'll be talking about will be still relevant by the time this comes out Tuesday.
Definitely.
But so, first of all, obviously, championship weekend, all the Power Five championships, all the also obviously Cincinnati, Houston, big
yes.
one. Where do we want to start off first? We want to kick it off with the actually let's kick it off with the first one, the Pac-12 championship that happened on Friday night. Trucial, we both had Oregon.
We both
had Oregon thinking, man, it's hard to beat a team twice.
Yeah,
this Oregon team's still pretty good. They can come
beat
back.
Ohio State. You thought they were going to put up a fight, but I mean, Oregon, their quarterback is not good. Like, he was just making so many dumb mistakes in that game, I felt like. It just, the moment was too big for him or something. Utah, they had veterans ready to go. They had that running back, and I'm blanking on his name right now, but he had a great story of being in his car last weekend, wishing that he had another chance to play college football because he had had some things go wrong. Gets a chance to come back, ends up scoring a bunch of touchdowns this season and killing it for Utah. So, exciting game.
Yeah, for sure. And credit to Utah. Utah's one of those teams that I feel like they're always pretty good. They're always a threat. They win a big game every now and then. They're a pretty dangerous team for the most part. But Utah is one of the most – does the best job, I feel like, one of the best jobs in the nation at player development. I feel like they take guys – like, they never have a super awesome recruiting class. They're great at creating just really good college football teams, especially over there in the Pac-12 and in Utah. I feel like they're always a team that you don't take lightly no matter who you are. And always a threat in the Pac-12, and obviously we saw that as they win another Pac-12 championship.
Yeah, that really started with Urban Meyer back in the day. Kind of just he built them into an actual Power 5 program, and then now they've been carrying that on and remain a threat here and there. But this year seems a little bit different.
When they move over to the Pac-12, early last year or the year before?
Oh, no, I thought it was way before that, wasn't it?
No, Utah's been in the Pac-12
for
a while.
Yeah, I thought it was like early 2000s.
No.
I'll find it.
Yeah, they're in the Mountain West, I thought, like forever.
Yeah, we may be wrong on that, but I thought they were in the Pac-12 for a while.
Don't worry, I've got it. 2011.
Okay.
So it's been, you're right. It's been
we split the difference.
It's been 10 years. Yeah. Okay. It has been.
So I was thinking it was 20, but it was only 10.
I don't know why I thought it hadn't been that long. Oh, well.
But yeah, I mean, Utah pretty much wire to wire in control.
Yeah, I mean, I watched a little bit of it, but Oregon was just playing so bad that I didn't want to watch anymore. You know?
Yeah, not much to that one. Then we roll into Saturday, and first big one. Well, you had the MAC championship early in the day, but then you had, obviously, the SEC championship, kind of what we want to get into.
MACtion.
And I really don't remember exactly what I said last week. I'm pretty sure I said I wouldn't be surprised if Bama won. I know I told some people that when they asked me about it. For all I have seen from Georgia, hadn't led me to believe that they would get kind of crushed like they did. But I will, and I'll talk about this later when we talk about the playoff. I did know Georgia really hadn't played anyone.
Yeah.
They hadn't been tested. I feel like we touched on that. Georgia, the best team they played is still Clemson. And that was in a week one game against Clemson where their offense didn't even score a touchdown. And they won 10-3. And no, Clemson's turned out to be a solid team.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, they're good. 9-3, right?
They're good, but not great. They don't have Georgia doesn't have a single great win on their resume this year. And they had the easiest schedule in all of the SEC, right?
Probably. Being in the East and not having to play Alabama.
I think they did. At least on the graphic I saw, I don't know if it didn't include all SEC teams or whatever, but I know if they're not at the bottom, they're close to it.
Well, I think probably the Arkansas win is maybe technically their best win.
That's what I would think.
Because it was a game where you just beat them up and down.
And Arkansas didn't even score a point, did they?
No, I think it was 37-0. Yeah. And Arkansas's, again, not a great team, but a ranked, like, top 25 team. I think they're around 22 or 23 or something. But yeah, just they had never really been tested, and we saw that they couldn't keep up with Alabama. Now, I don't know how that'll look when we get into the playoff, if that'll kind of light a fire under them, or if they're not going to be prepared, if they can't keep up. Because if you look at the four teams in the playoffs, in the playoff, every one of those teams except for Georgia has a huge win. You have Alabama, who obviously just crushed Georgia.
Yeah, but they
they play in the West. They crushed Ole Miss, also another top 10 team.
Mm-hmm.
Then you have Michigan, who pretty much crushes Ohio State.
Yeah.
And then dominates 42-3
absolute in the domination. Big Ten
championship. And say whatever you want about Iowa. I don't think Iowa's that great either, but Iowa's also not a team that you just blow the doors off of.
No.
Because of the style they play. It's so hard to get a lead and get a big lead on them, and Michigan just kind of gave them a taste of their own medicine, just kind of slowly wore them down and just kept punching and punching and got it. Then you have Cincinnati, who has
beat top Notre five Dame. Win. Yeah.
Yeah, Notre Dame's sitting there right on the outside, number five, and Cincinnati went to South Bend and didn't dominate, but controlled it wire to wire, you know? Came out and won that. I think they led the entire game.
Yeah.
And it was in South Bend, so you got a win on the road like that. Georgia doesn't have a win anywhere close to any of those.
No. I mean, Tennessee is one of their best wins. That's one of their best road wins, for sure.
Tennessee put up the most points on them.
And Tennessee put up the most points on them.
Well, until yesterday, yes.
Yeah. To Bama, of course.
And then I think technically, if you go by record, maybe Kentucky. Well, actually, no. I guess Clemson and Kentucky are both 9-3. So, either way, you didn't even beat a double-digit win team like these other teams did.
Yeah.
I don't know.
And we were just so, I think the whole country was just so enamored by their defense. They were holding teams to 6.7 points a game all year. That was the average. I know they didn't play anybody fantastic, but everybody was just so astounded by their defense, and nobody could score on them. They're like, oh, okay. You know, they're number one for sure.
Well, and the thing is they didn't play any good offenses until Tennessee. Tennessee was probably the best offense they played.
Yeah.
Until Alabama.
Bama, of course.
But. One of my friends who went to Alabama, he told me today that he saw a stat that Stetson Bennett threw eight passes in the fourth quarter yesterday, and he had only thrown eight passes in the fourth quarter all season up until that point.
Right, he barely even because played
he
in
didn't
the even, second
he
half.
He didn't have they to play in the fourth quarter, yeah.
Yeah. And I feel like people the whole season have kind of put that to the wayside, like you said, Reese, with how good their defense was. I mean, Stetson Bennett, he's good, and he can make some athletic plays, but he's not a superstar quarterback in the SEC at all.
We saw that last year, too.
Yeah.
I thought it was proven last year. I'm like, this guy, you know, he's okay.
Serviceable, but
he never struck me as a national championship quarterback.
No.
So I have a question for y'all on that, because I kind of said throughout the year, just off of what I was seeing, I thought Stetson Bennett, like you said, was serviceable, and I was under the impression he was pretty good. I still don't think he's bad, but, you know,
it's
easy to look good when you have, you know, that much talent on your offense. Mm-hmm. You have those guys making plays for you, and give him credit. I've seen him make throws. I've seen him throw the deep ball and everything. However, when you get to where you're playing games, so Reese, I think Swaff was actually texting us this the other day. Simply put, what Georgia had done is they had Stetson Bennett in, even though JT Daniels may have been better. JT gets hurt or whatever, Stetson Bennett comes in, and you know you're winning by 30 or 40 in all these games, so why change anything?
Yeah.
So I can kind of understand that. However, seeing what we know now, as they were never really tested by another great defense or another defense that really, I guess Clemson, right?
Yeah.
But again, they only scored.
And they didn't score.
What was that, week one?
Week one.
Yeah, and their defense saved them.
And I don't know, did JT Daniels start that game or did Stetson Bennett start that game?
I think JT Daniels did.
Okay, but anyway. So basically what Georgia did was stick with this guy, Stetson Bennett, at quarterback because, hey, you're winning by 30. And I kind of understand that. However, were you just doing that because it was working, or did you really think he was the better quarterback?
Yeah.
Because what if JT Daniels is playing this whole year, and then you have a guy like him playing in the SEC championship? Because that's the thing, when you play competition, top five level competition, you have to have a playmaker at quarterback.
Yeah, you have to.
Or you have to have some recipe that's going to work, and they didn't really have a recipe. They had...
And especially when you're playing against a coach like Nick Saban, who's going to know how to dial up all these insane pressures and is going to be absolutely sending in heat, causing mayhem for your quarterback. You need to have a guy there that is going to be able to make plays.
Well, and even though Bama's defense these past couple of years hasn't been necessarily what it was maybe 10 years ago when it was all about defensive end, all about defense and running the ball, obviously, college football has changed a little bit, so it's a little harder to have a defense like that. However, Bama still has the best athletes on the field on their defense.
Yeah.
Guys like Will Anderson, their defensive linemen are always insane. They always have a great secondary. So even if they're giving up yards and points, they're going to get sacks, they're going to pick the ball off, and they're going to strip the ball. So Georgia hadn't really faced anything like that.
They didn't face a disruptive defense like that, really, since... And, I mean, Clemson, you can't even consider them, because if you look at the Pitt game, like, and Pitt's good this year. They're close to great, but I just don't know. I mean.
Yeah, I mean, it was weird to see Alabama be an underdog. And all of my Bama buddies have been telling me, like, you know, this year was supposed to be a rebuilding year. They had that great team last year with Devontae Smith and John Metchie and Najee Harris.
Yeah.
And all those guys who got drafted, Mac Jones. Like, this year was, I mean, they weren't expecting such a performance this year. I think, obviously, Alabama is accustomed, they're spoiled now, I think, to, you know, hey, we're going to win 11 or 12 games and be in the SEC championship every year. But this year, obviously, I think when they lost a bunch of guys, all these first-round talents, they weren't expecting it to. And they were an underdog yesterday, and, you know, look what happened. Like, they came out and just smacked Georgia in the mouth. And honestly, everybody who's a Bama fan's like, hey, yeah, we beat up on our little brother, and they're kind of right.
Yeah.
I loved what I don't remember if it was like Danielson or one of the commentators on the game said it, but he quoted Ric Flair and said, to be the man, you got to beat the man. And I loved that, honestly, because Georgia, you haven't done it. You're not the man. And that's why Georgia has had a real problem ever since they got Kirby, essentially, with basically acting like they're Alabama.
Yeah.
Except the problem is you still don't have a national championship since 1984 or whenever it was with, I think, Herschel Walker.
Yeah, it was Herschel Walker.
They have a national championship. You're really good. That's cool and everything, but you haven't won the big one.
You can't win
yet.
The big one, yeah.
Yeah, and you haven't. And I mean, they're in the playoffs still, so they have a chance. I just don't see it happening.
And we all said, like, for the past month or so, or maybe even further than that, this has been Georgia's best team that we've seen up to this point.
Yeah.
You know, with Kirby Smart. And they still couldn't do it yesterday.
Still couldn't do it.
And I mean, I know it was like, you know, final score 24-41, Alabama wins. But, like, for the most part, Alabama dominated that game. I mean, Georgia really couldn't do much at all. Alabama made the big plays that they needed to.
Yeah. After a certain point, like
after the first quarter,
pretty early in the game, once Bama got up a couple scores, it never really looked back. Like Georgia kind of scored and kept it from being a total blowout.
But
at the end of the game,
they were never in control and never really.
And they never really had a chance to actually come back in the game.
And Stetson Bennett had two interceptions. One was a pick six. I mean,
and then
they couldn't run the ball.
The face mask blunder, the snap.
Oh,
that dunked him right in the head.
That became a meme.
Well, and they called it back, too. They said the line wasn't set all the ways. And that was so – I thought that was kind of a BS call.
That was BS.
Because the line was set. They said they weren't set for a second or something. And I was like, okay, come on. That's that's the reason they probably snapped it was because of the blunder or whatever. I don't know.
Yeah.
Just a dumb call, in my opinion. Anyway. We can go ahead and move on to – actually, let's talk Big 12 championship real quick. Baris, what were you going
to say? No, I saw a funny meme, and I think you guys might appreciate this. It was, you know, somebody put a – it's like a Scooby-Doo meme when the Scooby-Doo gang catches the villain or the guy causing mischief.
I know what you're talking about.
And they have to, like, take off his mask and reveal who it is. Well, the first mask was Kirby Smart's face, and they took off his face, and it became Mark Richt.
Mark Richt 2.0.
Yeah.
Can't win the big game.
So they're basically just saying that Kirby Smart is Mark Richt, and Mark Richt could never win the big one either.
Yeah, I think Mark Richt actually had one more SEC title than Kirby currently does in this, like, up to this point in their Georgia tenures.
Yeah, those
don't quote me on that.
Those Aaron Murray teams were dominant. back in like 2011.
Yeah, I mean, Mark Richt had good teams and always – he kind of always won around 8 or 9 games or something. Yeah. And then would have like an SEC run every now and then. But anyway.
Yeah.
The Big 12 championship.
Insane.
Big 12 kind of getting me excited again.
Yeah.
Good for the Big 12. This is good for college football that you have teams like Baylor and Oklahoma State. Because Oklahoma State had a chance at a playoff.
Yeah, and they probably should have.
They had a real argument. If Oklahoma State wins this game, there's a real argument, and I really hope – I feel like the committee would have really botched it, but they should have at least had a real discussion about putting Oklahoma State in if they won this game. Oh, however
– I think they would have made it in over Cincinnati.
See, well, that – but I disagree with that.
Why? Because it would be Michigan, Alabama, Georgia, OSU.
Why? I don't think Georgia should have gone in.
Really?
They're 12-1.
So you think Georgia falling
because Oklahoma State won their conference championship
1-5,
and they would have been 12-1, and they would have had more top 10 wins.
But you know,
they would have had a better. See, this is the problem.
But you know, the committee hates like group of five teams like Cincinnati and give them no respect.
Well, that's not. Yeah, but Cincinnati was undefeated and had a top 5 win.
Yeah,
they have. That's the thing. I mean, I know they didn't play like the entire season. But the resume, you could argue, is better.
Yeah.
Georgia doesn't have a big win. All those other teams that have big wins.
So, I mean, you could definitely make a case. It just would have been crazy to see a team fall from number 1 to number 5.
I know.
In an SEC team of all that, things. Well, but,
and that's the problem. If it's not an SEC team, the conversation is there.
Yeah.
Because it's an SEC team, there's not even – no one even really mentions it, especially in the committee.
That's true.
I might dive into that a little bit later too, but there's too much of a bias going on with the SEC and everything. Anyway,
well, let's get back to the Big 12.
Well, I mean, I don't know if it's bias. I mean, I think the bias might be warranted. Look at what the SEC has done like the past
right,
decade.
But that's what I'm saying. I think it's, I don't think it is what it used to be.
Well, the East, maybe not, but
that's what I'm saying.
We digress.
What division is Georgia in?
The East.
Okay. Anyway, we'll dive into that in a little bit. However, Baylor, Oklahoma State, wild game. Baylor jumps out like right away.
Yeah.
To a
quick
21-6 lead.
Maybe that sounds more. Right.
Maybe it was 21-0. I don't know. But Oklahoma State kind of hangs around, does their thing.
Yeah.
The problem was is the quarterback threw 4 picks. I mean,
you can't win.
To win a game when you win 4 picks. However, they had a shot.
They had 4 shots.
Yeah, they had 4 shots. And on the 4th and final shot, Kevin Dyson action. They are in just like inches short.
Yeah. I mean, it was first and goal on the 2. And they had 4 chances to get in that end zone, and they couldn't do it. That's just crazy. To
Spencer
like
Sanders.
You said, possibly make it to the playoffs too. You'd think the boys would be fired up enough. The boys in the trenches would be fired up enough to get you
make
those
push,
2 young.
Make a push.
This is the playoffs we're talking about. Are you kidding me?
But hey, shout out to Baylor. I mean,
yeah, you got to give them credit 100%.
Because what did they what are they in the rankings now? I know the bowl games are out, but they've got to be close to. They got to be like 7 or something, probably.
Yeah, something like that. Because it's is Notre Dame 5, Ohio State is 6.
Yeah,
so then Baylor 7. Yeah, that sounds right.
Hmm. But, good game there. Was that during? That was in the morning, or was that during the SEC championship?
That was at 11 a.m.
Okay, yep.
So that was
11
the first
a.m.
one, actually.
Yeah, I mean, dude, Spencer Sanders stinks. I remember watching him. It's kind of like Stetson Bennett. I remember watching one of his games last season, and he played like a doofus. And like I knew from then, I'm like, dude, this guy can't. He can't win it. Like he may be okay, but he's not the guy. And yesterday, he throws 4 picks. So. Don't want to say I called it, but I kind of called it. Spencer Sanders, not good.
Yeah, not too good. Rough day for him. But, I mean, kind of feel bad for – well, actually, I don't feel bad for Mike Gundy. Because screw Mike Gundy. He has screwed over Tennessee too many times. I was about to say it, and then I bit my tongue. I'm glad Mike Gundy lost. He can go screw off.
I like Gundy all right.
I mean,
but
he has a problem
now with winning. He's had – this is kind of his second legit shot at a possibility of a national championship, and they've kind of botched it.
But I mean, at a program like Oklahoma State, he played. He played quarterback there in the 80s.
No, he's one of the. I'd say he's top. I don't know if I'd say top, maybe top 10, but I'd definitely say top 15 coach in college football for sure.
I'd agree with that, and he might have the safest job in college football outside of Nick Saban.
Pat Fitzgerald too.
Oh yeah, Pat Fitzgerald. That's right. Yeah. Purple Vandy.
But yeah.
We want to keep moving and talk about the ACC championship here. Pitt, like we were talking about, and the fake slide. That's what I want to bring up here real quick before we fully get into the game. I want to get this out of the way. Fake slide, total BS. You should not be able to do it.
So let's preface this with, first time I saw it, I was like, that's sick. That's hilarious. Yeah. And he took off and did it.
But then you thought about it.
Then I thought about it, and I saw a few other people making their case for why it sucks that that's allowed. Because think about how much defenders are already getting like screwed over with this. Like, you can barely touch the quarterback today in football.
Can't touch the receivers.
And when a quarterback, it's the rule, I think, is like in the process, like at the beginning, when the quarterback begins to let himself up, like you have to lay off essentially. Yeah,
completely.
Like, you can't hit him on his way down. Can't touch him,
can't like, anything.
Any kind of, if you touch the guys, he's going down, they're going to throw a flag on you and it sucks.
Good chance.
So the fact that you can kind of fake slide, I mean, that's you're doing the beginning of the process where the defender is supposed to like let you slide, essentially.
Yeah.
So it's totally unfair for the defender when they're literally doing what they are told to do, like by rule. And then the quarterback is able to like get up and like just keep going. No, come on.
It's unfair to the defender completely. And they can't even, like you said, if you ease up, then the guy takes off like Kenny Pickett and he scores a touchdown. But if you don't, you're getting the flag. So your hands are tied and it's completely pushing towards the offense, the advantage to the offense side. So,
well, because now you're either the rules going to suck, you're going to have, I don't know how they're going to call it, but now you're going to have coaches that say, no, take his freaking head off.
Yeah.
You know?
So slide him up.
The goal is safety, like keeping players safe. Well, if you allow them to do fake slides and stuff, guys are just going to start getting their heads blown off because the coach is going to say, screw that. Don't let him take off. Don't let him. Make sure he's down. That's going to be the advice relayed to the players. Like, just make sure he's down, whatever you do. And that guy's going to be. There's going to be guys actually sliding and defenders just clobbered. Boom, right in the head.
Yeah, they're going to get some Vontaze Burfict type hits on those guys. Honestly, like I agree with you. I think it's dumb that, you know, the defender's hands are tied.
Yeah.
You know, because if I hit him, it's going to be a penalty. But if I, you know, let him slide because he looks like he's going to slide, you know, he could run away just like Kenny Pickett. I'm honestly kind of shocked that nobody's done that before.
Yeah, I don't know.
Why haven't we seen a fake slide before? Kenny
Pickett's the one who did it. Well, Mike Vick did it back in the day because his was like the sick like fake.
Yeah,
that was like allowed because he like got down and like spun around.
Yeah, spun around.
I'll allow that.
Yeah,
I think I've seen.
We'll allow that.
I'm surprised somebody like Kyler Murray or Baker or
Mahomes. That's a Mahomes move right there.
Yeah,
because he loves the no look pass. Loves that flashy stuff. So. I'm surprised Mahomes hasn't tried to do something.
I honestly say screw the slide. Let the players hit the quarterback again.
Let's take out the slides. Old school
football.
I kind of like that.
Well, the slide is stupid in my
opinion. Make them slide head first.
The slide. Cool. Well, I was going to say the slide is stupid in my opinion anyway because you're downed now where you start your slide.
You don't even get any extra yards from how far you slide.
Yeah, so I'm always like, just dive. Like, learn how to dive safely.
Yeah.
You're not even really going to make...
Learn how to Taylor Heineke.
Yeah. Like, Kate McNamara did it the other night on a 3rd-and-12. Took a dive to get the first down, and it was clean. No one was there. He just dove forward.
Smart move.
Just eliminate the slide.
Maybe instead of a slide, you have to sit crisscross applesauce. You
got to do something.
You just have to take a seat.
I mean,
you can't really fake a seat and then start running again.
Yeah, so that kind of takes the fake aspect out of the game.
Put me on the rules committee.
Yeah, you might be onto something here, Reese.
Yeah. But yeah, I mean, otherwise, it was pretty sick, but also not fair for defensive players. And hey, I saw on Twitter, this is kind of good for Tennessee. You lost to Pitt early in the year.
Yeah.
Everybody's like, oh, we shouldn't have lost that game. We could have won XYZ. But hey, turns out they're
really
ACC
good.
Champion.
Yeah.
So.
And Will and I were both at that game, and it was like the most frustrating thing to ever watch. We're not going to get too big into the Tennessee Pitt game. We've already talked about it, but should have beat them. Should have beat the ACC champs. Ugh. So, but you live and you learn. Heupel's the guy. I'm good.
Yeah, but Texas A&M takes on the loser of the ACC championship, Wake Forest, in the Jacksonville, the Gator Bowl, I think.
Oh, yeah.
So, I don't know how that's going to go.
That'll be interesting. Also,
what are your thoughts?
Is Texas A&M the best team in the country since we beat Alabama?
No.
You know, if you do that math, we're the only one to beat them, so we should be number one.
Yeah.
Obviously.
Weren't we talking about sarcastic. How earlier in the year you could work your way back to Bowling Green being the best team in the country or something like that?
Probably.
Yeah. It has something. Who did Texas A&M lose to?
We lost to Arkansas, Mississippi State, LSU, and Ole Miss.
There's definitely someone in there that along the road. It's because I think Bowling Green beat Minnesota. That's where it all.
Oh yeah,
it all starts going.
Yeah, it starts going from there.
Bowling Green, congrats! You're number one.
Yeah.
Wow. Bowling Green, is huge.
Honestly, I don't know. We play Wake Forest. It's kind of the same thing. We live by Calzone or die by Calzone. If that guy plays well, then we win. If not, we lose. So, I'm kind of done with this season. I'm hype about the recruiting that's going to happen, and I'm hype about next season. This year was kind of a disappointment.
You think Quinn Ewers is headed to A&M?
No.
There were murmurs. There were murmurs that, I mean, he's from Texas, so.
What happened to that guy?
Just transferring.
Yeah.
Yeah, but is he
sitting behind CJ Stroud, so yeah. He wants to go play.
I think there were three or four, like, four-star freshmen in that quarterback room, so not a good. You know,
yeah.
four and five star guys in the quarterback room, so not a good thing to have necessarily.
Mm-hmm.
Or not a, you're not keeping all those guys, you know, because I think Jack Miller is the other one who a lot of people at Nebraska were talking about maybe getting him in the transfer portal because I think he's a redshirt freshman or sophomore. And, you know, I mean, the thing is, Stroud being a freshman, anyone who's there, you know, Stroud is pretty much locked in for at least the next 2 years. So, even if you sit around, you're only going to have 2 years of playing time, which in today's college football world apparently is not enough.
Yeah.
No, I mean, I don't blame him. I would want to go play too. If you're, I mean, especially, I think Ewers is like technically the same class as Stroud.
Well, but Ewers reclassified to get there early.
Yeah. Which ended up.
But isn't Stroud a freshman? They're both technically like freshmen.
Well, yeah, but he wouldn't even be in college right now.
Well, yeah, I know that.
So he could have been like Stroud would be a sophomore.
Well, part of that
Ewers would have been a redshirt freshman, like redshirted, and then been a freshman by the time Stroud was a junior.
Yeah.
And then Stroud could have gone to the NFL. So,
well, part of the reason Ewers did that, I read about it, was he couldn't make any money due to like laws in Texas, so he wanted to get out of Texas and start doing NIL stuff in Ohio where he can make money. So that's why he did it early.
I knew he was set to make a ton of money.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, no, he got like some million dollar
deal. Yeah.
He's like the number two rated quarterback ever or something.
Yeah.
Yeah.
He's like a, you know, I talked about it. They grade the recruits on like a scale of one. He's like a 0.9999.
Yeah.
So he's
once in a generation, apparently, type of talent.
Yeah. Allegedly.
We'll see.
But
stars
also,
don't matter.
I had a take. I think I texted you guys about it. It's talking about A&M. If Kellen Mond is A&M's quarterback this year, we might go to the playoff. And he might win Heisman.
I don't know about that.
I don't know, dude.
I think Kellen Mond and like Adrian Martinez
no.
are like the
same. Oh, my.
No. Kellen Mond is
about that.
Way better
than
Adrian
Martinez. Didn't Kellen Mond get drafted in the third round?
Kellen Mond, yeah, because he has a better arm. But as far as just college players, like both stat sheet stuffers that like never really won anything.
Yeah, that's fair.
Well, but Kellen Mond dealt with two coaches too. I mean, he was at the tail end of Kevin Sumlin, and then the start of Jimbo.
Adrian Martinez dealt with like a terrible.
Yeah, but Adrian Martinez is bad. Adrian Martinez plays in the Big Ten.
Uh-oh.
Boom roast.
Uh-oh.
Are we getting into this SEC fake bias?
No, well, it's not fake bias. I have stats in front of me.
Oh, you're saying you got you got the stats already ready to go to talk about.
I told you I'd pull them up.
Yeah,
there you go.
No, I don't know. I mean, I know. I don't know. I think Kellen Mond, if he
like
was
what
on this
Kellen
team
Mond,
this year,
he never really won anything. You'll beat UNC, right? Like
we won the Orange Bowl last year. We finished
never,
in the top four.
He never really like there was always hype around him winning like a SEC title or going to the playoff, and it never happened.
Well,
Texas A&M always has hype. I'm just saying, if he was on the team this year, we probably could have I mean, we beat Bama, so.
Yeah.
The only reason we lost those games against Ole Miss, LSU, Arkansas, and is because our quarterback sucked.
Yeah, but Kellen, he wasn't. He was good, but he wasn't like.
By the time he was a senior, like he, I mean, he was a veteran. He was poised. I mean, he got drafted in third round. I mean, pretty good.
Yeah, but I thought that was more so over just like potential.
Yeah,
like he has a great arm. I'll give him that, but. Mm-hmm.
Who knows?
He was a guy who, like again, kind of like Adrian Martinez, like set all the career records basically just because he was there the longest.
Yeah, that is true. He was there the longest. I'm looking up Adrian Martinez stats.
Uh-oh. Okay.
If I can type
They're probably correctly. Not far off, actually, if you want to go just stats.
Career stats.
Because I know Martinez has over 10,000 yards.
Does he really?
Yeah.
Well, I guess, like you said, he's a four-year starter. He's been there for so damn long.
Reese is looking.
No, yeah. Well, I'm trying to. Why I don't know why ESPN doesn't add them up for me, but oh, maybe it will do this. I don't know. I just thought it was. It is a hot take for sure, but you know.
Yeah.
He has only Adrian Martinez only has 8,400 yards.
No, that's not right.
How can it not be? That's what it says.
Is that passing
from 2018?
I think you're looking at just passing, probably.
Well, yeah. That's what. Why would you not look at just passing?
You would look at total yards.
Well, I wasn't doing that. He has 2,000 rushing. 2,300 rushing yards.
Yeah.
So obviously that if you, yeah, but you, people don't. I mean,
yes, you do. You count a quarterback's total yards if he can run.
No, I know that.
That's part of his game.
But you were comparing passing, though.
No, I was just comparing them as players. They're both guys who just like were stat sheet stuffers that never won anything. Obviously, Kellen
Mond. Well, we won an Orange Bowl. So.
Yeah, you won a lot more games, obviously.
In the SEC.
But I would say Texas A&M was also way more talent. Like, he had a way better surrounding cast.
Certainly. Yeah. There's no debate about that.
I mean, Adrian Martinez's best year was probably his freshman year still when he had a 1,000-yard rusher. And every other year since then, he's been the leading rusher on the team.
Really?
Yeah.
God, that is terrible.
See, that's what I'm saying.
Like, that is terrible.
We've been bad. We've been really bad.
God.
Like, I think wherever he goes next year, he'll do fine. Like, I don't think he's an NFL quarterback, but he'll do well at if he goes to the right fit that has some kind of supporting cast, he'll do fine.
So Kellen Mond has more passing yards but less rushing yards. So.
Yeah.
I mean, if we really wanted to look at this from a million different angles, we could.
Yeah, we could. Yeah. We will.
We could all day. And there's no right answer. I mean, because...
Adrian Martinez has 30 interceptions in his career. Kellen Mond has 27.
Whoa.
I know. Crazy.
Who threw more passes, though?
Oh, wow.
I don't know. I would think Kellen Mond.
Right? I would think Kellen Mond. Yeah.
Kellen Mond has 1,358. Adrian Martinez... Only 1,055.
Ooh, so Kellen Mond actually a lot more inaccurate.
No.
Or wait. Just throws way more.
Yeah, Adrian Martinez has 139 passer rating. Kellen Mond only had 132.
Boom. See, I'm telling you, like, the rating is there. I'm telling Martinez was a stat sheet stuffer. Just didn't win any games.
Yeah.
So, which is the most important stat?
That is the most important
stat. That's true. Can a quarterback win a Super Bowl? Ask Swofford. That's all that matters, apparently. Yeah.
Well, we saw what happened to the Chiefs last year.
I actually wrote an article about this past week that went out pretty recently. And I basically just alluded to the fact that Tom Brady didn't win the Bucs that Super Bowl last year.
It was the defense.
Yeah. Patrick Mahomes was not able to win a Super Bowl on his own.
Yeah. I mean, it's like Peyton when they won Super Bowl 50 against the Panthers.
Yeah, gosh. That's like the prime example.
Yeah.
Is the Peyton Super Bowl. His second one, obviously.
Because he was just short of decrepit in that Super Bowl. Yeah. Like, it was.
He ran for a first down in that Super Bowl, and everyone on earth was holding their breath.
Yeah, he's going to die. Yeah, it's kind of like what Big Ben has become this year. Like, a couple of weeks ago, Big Ben had that designed keeper run for about 2 yards, and it was the weirdest play call I've ever seen.
It just takes him so much to get going.
Yeah, but he's a big man once he gets barreling downfield.
Well, I'll eat my words. I mean, Adrian Martinez, he's pretty good, I guess.
Pretty good. Stat sheet stuffer.
Now that we've gone over that.
Gotten that out of the way.
Let's hop into the Big Ten Championship. In which Michigan just absolutely dominated.
Yeah.
Which is what I predicted. And I had a buddy text me saying, man, I think Iowa's going to win this game. And I said, I don't know if Iowa will score. So I guess I was wrong. They scored three. They did three, score. But, man, I really didn't think it would be this bad. I did. I saw like a 31-10 type game.
Wow.
But Michigan, from credit to Jim Harbaugh for kind of, for opening up the playbook there in the first half or first quarter or whatever it was, getting the big run for a 60-plus yard touchdown, getting the ball back and immediately going trick play, throwback pass for a 65-yard touchdown.
Yeah.
And if you get up on Iowa that much, and if you don't make a lot of mistakes, it's hard for Iowa to get back in the game. Iowa lives off of other teams making mistakes and just letting them back in the game. Because if you watch that game, all Iowa does is play field position battles. They pin Michigan inside the 10 like five times. I mean, it seemed like every time Iowa's punting, but they were just putting it way deep in Michigan's side of the field. And that's what they try and do, and they just run the ball and throw swing passes to the tight ends, and they kept doing it, and Michigan
was ready.
Especially in the second half, McDonald, the DC of Michigan, said, hey, we're not going to let them throw that tight end pass anymore. And next thing you know, they're getting pressure on the quarterback and covering the tight end, and there's nowhere for them to go with the ball. And Iowa's quarterbacks, they don't have playmakers.
They're not good.
It's the same Iowa team that's always been around, except this year the quarterbacks are probably even worse.
Yeah.
So, I mean, good for – I'm kind of happy for Michigan, too.
They finally did it. Harbaugh, he's been there since, what, 2013? Or
it's been 8 or 9 years.
It was
years.
The year after he lost the Super Bowl in the championship, the Harbaugh Bowl, when the Ravens beat the Niners, and then I know he went to Michigan after that. So it's been 8 years or 9 years, whatever it took. They finally did it. They got the monkey off their back. They're in the playoffs. They beat Ohio State. They won the Big Ten. They had, I think, Michigan, I saw today, there was a stat for them to make the playoffs at the beginning of this year was like 0.1%. ESPN had them, something like that. It was low. So, hey, Michigan overcame the odds.
Well, yeah, because they went, what, 2-7 last year?
Yeah.
I know it was COVID year, so it was weird. But also kind of refreshing to see a team like Michigan who's stuck with a coach get here and get to the playoff.
Yeah.
Because we're not. Because everybody's that
been calling for Harbaugh's head. Of that you see all the time.
Well, and I just mean in college football in general, it's become we're not getting to the playoff. Teams that aren't even shouldn't even be concerned about that necessarily. That haven't been in the national championship conversation in a long time, but now have these expectations of if we're not winning conference titles or getting to the national championship, we need to fire this guy after 3 years. You know, so kind of refreshing to see a team go, hey, we're going to stick with our guy.
For we think,
8 or 9 years, even though he's done okay, but he hasn't won anything yet. And now look at him. If nothing else, you got a conference championship. You haven't had one of those since 2004, where they had split it.
They had never done it in the Big Ten. Like, since it became the Big Ten.
They hadn't done it since there's been a game. Yeah.
Yeah.
Since there's
yeah.
been a Big Ten championship game. Correct. Which also I thought, man, what's up with Michigan and splitting everything? Last thing they had was a Big Ten championship they split with Iowa.
Oh, yeah, that's right.
Last natty they had was 97. They split with the Huskers. Michigan, get your own. Yeah. Hey, thanks for winning a Big Ten championship so you can stop sharing
with everyone. Yeah, stop sharing with everyone. It's kind of like a tie in the NFL.
Yeah, but I'm excited to see them in the playoff for sure.
So, yeah, and I think Michigan's legit. I'm interested to see like what kind of noise they make in the playoffs. I don't think they're going to win the national championship. I don't even...
Do you think they'll win that first game against Georgia?
I think it's going to be closer than people think, but I think they lose it in a heartbreaking fashion.
Really? Gosh, I don't know.
I don't know either. I don't know, man.
Well, I was going to say this earlier. We have 26 days to figure it out. We have 26 days until like the playoffs happen. That's a long time. It doesn't feel like it's always that long, but I guess it is.
It's almost a month.
3 weeks for everybody to get right.
Because I could see, I mean, what we saw this past weekend, like, I feel like Michigan and Georgia are kind of the same team in a way. Like, two great defenses, allegedly. Like,
yeah.
Georgia obviously just got some points scored on them, but still good defense in general, I don't even know. Just kind of big picture good defense.
Yes, yes, 100%.
So, them and Michigan kind of match up there, and then they both have, like, Michigan's got a great 1-2 punch at running back, good receivers. Obviously, Georgia, good running backs, athletes on offense. And then they both kind of have two average quarterbacks playing, who I like McNamara, but you saw him make throws kind of in, I guess you could say, important times or make plays when he needed to, but isn't going to be that playmaker. No. So I don't know how much pressure this Georgia defense is going to get on him. I think that's going to cause a lot. Like, is Georgia's defense going to be kind of controlling the tempo or the mood of that when they're both out on the field, when Georgia's defense and Michigan are out on the field together? So I don't know, because if I think that's mainly what it comes down to. But I could also see, you know, if Stetson Bennett is out there, Michigan's defense is going to get back there and get pressure on them, just like they did with Iowa.
I think some of us are forgetting there's a third phase of football. It's called special teams. I tell you what, obviously Georgia didn't win yesterday, but their punter was just hitting some bombs. So honestly, I mean, a game like this where they're somewhat evenly matched, Georgia's offense isn't the greatest, their defense is solid. I mean, Michigan's offense is pretty good, their defense is solid. Like, it could come down to some special teams type stuff.
Well, it's funny you say that too, because in that Big Ten championship game, the whole time I was watching it, like, Michigan just kept rushing the punter. And I was like, man, they're so close to blocking it. And then they finally blocked one towards the end of the game.
Yeah. Block punts. Can you make all your extra points? Can you make a field goal? If you go for two, do you get it? Stuff like that. I think that could decide that game.
Yeah, yeah, in a tight game like that, it's going to come down to stuff.
Where we think the teams match up super well.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. But I don't know. I'm interested to see. I think, and maybe I am biased, but I think teams in the SEC have a better talent on the line of scrimmage, offense and defense. And I know the Northern teams, you know, they're good. They play trench football like Big Ten. It's like usually kind of a grudge match when they play each other. But I'm interested to see, because when Alabama and LSU, like when they won their natties, like they always have dominant defensive lines and offensive lines that will just push you around and open up holes. I don't know if Michigan has that. And I haven't watched enough to know if they have that. Well, I know they have the two edge rushers.
On the defensive
line. I know that, but I don't know. Obviously, I think the SEC teams have dominant line players.
Well, but that's what I feel like the Big Ten has on offensive line, for sure. Like, you think about teams like, even though not even Michigan, Ohio State necessarily, well, more even Iowa, Wisconsin, I think of as like offensive lineman Iowa. Like, you have, I feel like they have a first round guy coming out of there all the time.
Oh, it seems like every year.
Yeah, but I mean, it's like the reverse of SEC defensive linemen. Like, SEC defensive linemen come out into the draft and go to the NFL all the time.
Yeah.
So, I mean, that'll be interesting to watch. Can the big, like, country boy, white corn-fed dudes on the offensive line of Michigan take on the studs of the Georgia defensive line? Freaking the Davis.
Jordan Davis.
That guy's huge.
26 years old.
Well, he didn't even play well yesterday, I don't think.
Yeah, he was kind of getting bullied a little bit.
I mean, it'll be special teams, and I'm interested to see how the Lions play against each other.
Yeah.
I agree.
What else was I going to say? I was going to say, you know, obviously Ohio State must have had a good offensive line when they won, because Ezekiel Elliott ran all over the place. So.
Yeah.
Right. Yeah.
That was crazy. I don't think anyone really saw that game coming at all, or at least I didn't.
Yeah, they won the first one.
I mean, I just knew
Cardale Jones was really
good. I didn't see it with Cardale Jones. Well, actually, no, yeah, because that was the year I think they won the Big Ten championship like 70-3 or something.
Yeah,
Wisconsin. Or yeah, like 56 they blew to 3.
Yeah, that's right.
It was Cardale's first game, and I saw that, and I was like,
oh my god,
be okay. And everyone else took it as, like, oh, Wisconsin's just not that good. And I'm like, no, Wisconsin's pretty good. Like,
they might just be.
I think Ohio State's good. Just really good. But anyway. Last game we'll talk about, and we don't have to cover it too much, but Cincinnati-Houston, we talked about the line being kind of big and ended up being, you know, obviously Cincinnati covered it. But, you know, Houston
had the first half was close. I mean, it was tight the first half. But
Cincinnati took care of business.
They did.
What they had to do.
And then the third quarter there, you can see they scored 21 points, so they came out firing in the second half, knew what the stakes were and took care of business.
And I think that's a, Houston's legit. They're a good
team. Yeah, like we were talking about, they are going to give Auburn trouble.
Is that who they're playing?
Yeah.
They're playing Auburn? Yeah. I think I'd be more surprised if Auburn won, honestly.
Yeah, and Auburn's crumbling right
like,
now.
Like, I won't be that surprised.
Weren't they 6-2 and they've lost four straight?
Will Bo Nix play?
I don't know, but...
TJ Finley stinks. Well, maybe that guy sucks.
But he might not even play, because remember, he's on one leg.
Yeah. I don't know.
They might. Who knows?
They'll bring Nick Marshall back.
Oh, I'd love Nick Marshall.
Or do that. Just put a DB or like receiver, a quarterback, yeah. Let him run around.
Just let him run around.
It works, man. People don't do that enough, honestly. You need to have a secret weapon quarterback.
Oh, yeah. And especially when you can do it in college. Why not? Just do it.
So let's jump in. Talk about the playoff picture. We already touched on it a little, got a little heated, so we'll see how this talk goes. So let's just run through top four. So at one you got Bama.
Yep.
Any problems there with that?
No, they just beat the number one team. They're
soundly.
They beat them soundly. They've got the resume. They beat everybody in the West except A&M, and it took a game-winning field goal. So. I think Alabama, easy number one.
Yeah, I have no problems there. And then
they've proven it.
Yeah.
When they were down, I mean, obviously the close games with LSU and Florida, but I mean,
I'll get to it in a minute.
But okay. I think they are deserving of number one for sure.
The one thing I will say about this Bama team, I think they deserve the ranking, and I could see them winning the national championship. So this point that I'm about to make doesn't necessarily matter. However, this Bama team like isn't as good as some of Saban's Bama teams before, I would say, just because, and he even said it.
Yeah.
He didn't say this like directly about this team, but he talked about being good versus being good all the time. And I think this Bama team is good when it matters,
basically.
Like that's why they A&M had their number. But then Auburn, that was kind of a slip-up game. Auburn's not that good.
No.
Auburn's not
and
that good.
And like Reese was saying, Florida and LSU, they've had a couple other tight games. But they always took care of business when it mattered.
Right. And then, not you always, know what, they had SEC loss, championship but, game,
yeah.
They got up for it and they came to play. And it looked like any other Bama team. Bryce Young's really good. Obviously, there's a drop-off. Like you said, your buddies were worried about rebuilding. But you have guys like Mechie, who actually is going to be injured, it looks like.
Yeah, towards ACL.
Yeah, that sucks.
Sucks.
But you got receivers all – you have athletes all over the place.
Well, you got – I mean, the thing for Alabama is they've got a guy right behind him who's just as good.
Right. They're stacked always. So,
like in the Iron Bowl when Williams got – kicked out of the game for that targeting
call. Yeah,
the next guy who came in for him caught like game tying touchdown.
Yeah,
so or was it overtime or something? I don't know. So Alabama, yeah, they can replace their guys.
Yeah, hurt. I mean they reload every year. The depth is so insane at Alabama.
Well, and you know, I don't think we forget, but Bryce Young is a freshman.
Yeah, they still got him for a couple more years.
This is what I was gonna say. It was like 3 or 4 weeks ago when we were trying to talk about Heisman. I was like, you know, I think it's going to be Bryce Young. And obviously, I gave a big, you know, if this happens, and I said, if they beat Georgia in the championship, well, they did, and it looks like, you know, he's going to be the guy.
Yeah, and he threw over 400 yards against what everyone was claiming was a generational type of defense.
Yeah.
So, yeah, he all but won it in that one game.
I think so.
Let's move on to Michigan at number two. Any problems there?
I mean... I don't have any problems with it. I mean, you got to put them there because you can't put Georgia over them, I think, after that crushing of a loss. And then, obviously, Cincinnati has to be number four. So, I think Michigan, they're where they should be.
Right. Well, because I think your one loss is to Michigan State, who is a ranked team.
Yeah.
You know.
Very good team.
You beat Ohio State, who's currently six, right?
Yeah,
who six. A lot of people think is... If one of these other teams were to lose, like maybe Ohio State's the team to jump in somewhere,
mm-hmm.
whatever you want to say about that. Anyway, it's a top win, rivalry win, big time win for Michigan, and they won by a couple scores. So they had that, and then you have a performance like that in a conference championship game. I mean, 42-3.
It's insane.
You don't beat down a ranked team like that too often, you know? Like 42. usually there's even some trash touchdowns. You know, it might be 42-20 or something. 42-3. Like, you didn't get in the end zone. That's impressive, no matter who you're playing. Like, you did not get in the end zone.
It's pretty tough to hold a team to no touchdowns. I mean, there's always a garbage time score or something like that. But, yeah, Michigan, I think they're where they should be. What about Georgia, number three?
So this is where it gets fun.
This is where we stray away from each other.
Now, I know Will and Reese, I'm going to let you guys duke this out here between Georgia and Cincinnati, because we all know, obviously, if Georgia's number three, Cincinnati's number four. Where should both of those teams end up?
So here's the thing. First of all, Georgia has had, they're 12-1. Good year. Have a few ranked wins. I don't have a problem with them being in the playoff or anything necessarily, because I don't really think Notre Dame at 5 has a shot necessarily, or even necessarily deserves to be in there, because they didn't win a conference championship either, right? And then you have Ohio State, who's outside, that has lost 2 games, lost to Michigan, who's in there. So I don't really have a problem with them being in. But I do have a problem with them kind of being number 3, and I have a problem with there not being a conversation about another team jumping in. Yeah, because it was just
automatic.
Because we talked about it earlier, I think if Oklahoma State would have won that game, which they didn't, so it's irrelevant, right?
Yeah.
But if Oklahoma State wins that game, they deserve to hop in there, and I don't think Cincinnati deserves to drop out because they're undefeated, have a top 5 victory, and they've been doing it. They played a heck of a season last year and basically came in this season.
What do you mean? With a lot of hype.
Last year doesn't matter, though.
It does when you're a group of 5 team and having to prove yourself, because it's not just a 1-year thing. You have to have like a journey. Like, you have to win multiple years in a row.
Yeah, like how Boise State, even when they were in the mid-2000s and later 2000s having their great success, they still never really, and that was obviously BCS era, but
you're right, but they never
considered anything, and they had multiple BCS years.
BCS bowl victories, yeah, too.
Like, they were legit.
But anyway, so yeah, my thing is, like, if that were to happen, I don't think Cincinnati would have deserved to fallen out. I think Georgia would have deserved to fallen out.
That's fair to say.
And I think they deserve, the reason they're number 3 right now is because ratings, like, no one wants to see Alabama and Georgia play again.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, of course. That would be silly.
Well, why is it silly, though? Because it's just a ratings thing. Like, it has nothing to do with actually, like, what happened in all these games. Yeah,
and it kind of sucks that, well, no, that certainly is being taken into account.
The committee would be silly to just give them a second game right after you just saw Alabama beat them. Like, why?
Yeah, but it's
you're ranking the best 4 teams.
It's TV ratings shouldn't come into account for the college football playoff committee, I think is what Will is saying.
Yeah.
It should only be the top 4 teams with your resume. Like, yeah, nothing outside.
I don't really want to watch them play again anyway. However, technically, like, Michigan is like having to play like probably the better team now. Well, no, sorry. I don't know. I'm just saying I don't think Georgia like should be 3 in this situation. It's all because of TV ratings. And there's definitely no conversation about that either. I mean, it's definitely just like, oh yeah, Georgia, they'll be 3. They're still in the playoff. This game essentially didn't even matter.
Yeah. It was just seeding.
Yeah. It only mattered for Alabama.
Yeah.
I think Georgia's season, they dominated everybody except for Alabama.
They dominated a bunch of nobodies.
Arkansas, Auburn, who almost beat Alabama.
Auburn's 6-6.
Kentucky's top 25. I mean,
Kentucky lost to us.
Yeah, that's the thing. Like,
I don't know.
I mean, I get both sides.
I think
sides
if you watch the two teams on the field, I think you would say that Georgia's better than Cincinnati based on how they play.
I think that's...
I mean, Cincinnati, they have the Notre Dame win, yes. Like, but that's all they can hang their season on. I mean, besides being undefeated, of course. But
Georgia has nothing to hang their season on. They blew out a bunch of like solid to below average teams.
I mean, Cincinnati didn't play the most difficult schedule. That's what I just said. I'm like, yeah, that's what. But the other teams they played: Indiana, Temple, Navy, Tulane, like Murray State. Like, their schedule is not that much better. Besides the one Notre Dame game in the like earlier in the season.
They are the only undefeated team in football, though.
Yeah, not UTSA. Yep. Sad.
Oh, yeah. They got destroyed, didn't they? Or no, it was a comeback.
No, UTSA got blown out by North Texas
okay,
last
yeah,
week.
Okay, yeah, no. I was thinking of that. That's right.
I don't know. I mean, I've watched Georgia, so I just think they're a better team.
My problem, though, is... And I, like, again, I say...
And maybe I'm just biased because I watch more SEC football.
Right. And I don't... I actually... It starts to get to... There's this whole argument with the playoff and everything about deserving to and, like, the best four teams and everything, you know? Like, a lot of times there's been talks where a team that deserves to get in doesn't necessarily get in.
Yeah.
Because you go by the eye test and everything. Mm-hmm. And I really don't think that's screwed over anyone since the playoff's been around. Like, I don't think...
There hasn't been a major...
I don't think, like, when TCU got left out, like, I don't think they necessarily were going to win a national championship. No. But again, that's my opinion. That's me, like,
yeah,
just eye-testing them or whatever. The problem is, the problem I have with it is, right now, SEC East is not a good division.
I mean, outside of
Georgia.
Georgia. And we saw what happened to Florida this year. Kentucky's not.
Kentucky, like,
9-3. Tennessee's one of the better teams.
Kentucky's in second place in the East. They almost lost to UTC. They lost 23. I mean, they won 23-21. That's the second best team in the division? Really? I mean, that,
yeah.
I'm just saying it's not. I think the SEC West is still the best division in football.
Yeah.
But SEC East is a different ballgame. And when Georgia doesn't have to play Bama, Ole Miss,
Texas A&M,
LSU.
Yeah, did they play? I mean, obviously LSU's down.
No, they didn't.
When you have a year where you don't play any of those teams, you don't have that tough. Yeah. You get kind of the best break you can get.
Yeah,
I mean, that happens. But I think there's probably been Alabama teams in the past that they didn't have the toughest SEC schedule.
But they played in the West.
Yeah, but I mean, there's been down years in the West. I mean, LSU was bad for a few years. Texas A&M is, you know, they've been okay. Like, yeah. Arkansas has been really bad. Like,
yeah,
so the SEC West isn't always dominant. Auburn, I feel like the West Auburn's up and down.
I feel like the West has been dominant the past 10 to 15 years, though, compared to the rest of the
I don't know. I need to look.
To the East. Because when you, like, Auburn was
really
was
good.
Really Alabama and Auburn for a long time there. Yeah. And then you had a year where Ole Miss, Mississippi State were number one and number two.
Yeah, that's true. Chad Kelly season.
You had LSU going to national championships. You had... Anyway, I digress.
No, the SEC East, I mean, probably you're right. You know, SEC East has been, you know, the lesser of the two divisions recently.
My whole point on this, again, like, Georgia to me is one of the four best teams in the league still. But I think I think they fooled us a little bit. I think the resume is really not that good when you break it down.
But they had like several games. Let me see if I can count them real quick. They had several games where they like shut out their opponent. To like to have games where you don't let another college football team score is impressive, no matter who it is. Like not even a field goal. I mean, I know Georgia Tech is not the greatest team ever. They're terrible. Arkansas. They had a solid season, and, you know, for Arkansas to be really bad last year and to be better this year, and then they don't score a single point against Georgia, and then the other one's Vanderbilt. I don't even need to mention that. Clemson, first game of the year, they scored 3 points.
Yeah, they scored three.
Like, I mean, I just think some of those type games where you don't let the other team score, that's impressive. No, Cincinnati, and I totally forgot that I have a stance. I need to back up Cincinnati since I predicted them to make the playoff. So I'm flip-flopping here. So Cincinnati, congratulations. You did it. You proved me right. But also, I don't think I don't know. Well, no, you're stellar. You are. I love you. You made it. Now my prediction is right. I elevated you from dark horse to contender, and you did it. But also, I think Georgia is still really good.
Yeah. I would have really liked to have seen them play each other the first game, too, is part of it. Because I don't think Cincinnati's going to beat Alabama.
And, Will, I was wrong to tell you when you were talking about, you know, Cincinnati had a really good team last year. I was wrong when I was like, well, last year doesn't matter. Because then I was about to give you stats about the SEC and their bowl games recently. Because
it's been pretty good.
Yeah.
It's been good.
The SEC, national champions since 1992, the SEC has 15 national championships. Obviously, Alabama has a lot of those. But
the next
closest team since 1992, or the next closest conference in national championships, Big 12 has 5.
Yeah.
ACC has 5. Big 10 has 3. Pac-10 has 2. Like, the SEC has been dominant. And in bowl games since 2006, the SEC is 97-55. That's a 0.638 win percentage. And the next best like record in bowl games behind them is the Sun Belt, who's 32-20, which is a 0.615 percentage.
Yeah,
wow. I mean,
that's pretty impressive.
I will say
the top four like conference bowl records are SEC, Sun Belt, Mountain West, and then independent schools. And then it's Big 12, Pac-12, American Conference USA, ACC, and Big 10 is second to last. They have a 0.439 win percentage in bowl games since 2006. So, I mean, they're below 500 since 2006. So, I mean, the SEC, no matter, you know, even if you took Alabama out of those, it'd probably still be pretty good. I don't know.
I think you could also make that argument with a lot of the conferences. Like, with the ACC, like, you take out Clemson. With Big Ten, you take out Ohio State. You can do that with every conference.
Yeah, you can. Yeah, that's true.
But, I mean, the stats do tell the SEC has been dominant. So, obviously, they are going to get a little bit of bias by a committee or whatever. And it's deserving, I think.
That's what I think. That part of that's kind of my point, is I'm kind of excited to see what happens this year.
Yeah, because this will be a big...
Well, I'm not impressed with really anyone, right?
Well, but
not super impressed with anyone this year.
What about Bama? I mean, they've done it.
Yeah, but even like we said earlier, and like what Saban said, like, they're not really good all the time.
Yeah.
Like, they will be, I think, in the playoff. So, if I had to pick a national champion, I'm picking Bama right now, because I think they'll be up.
But they still look like they have some weaknesses.
They do. That's the thing. You don't know.
So I'm excited about this playoffs, and especially having a group of five team in there is going to be really fun.
Having Cincinnati get their shot, and then having a team like Michigan kind of
like
Michigan, no matter what happens, even if they lose like by a couple touchdowns or something, I think you can kind of say like Michigan is back in a way.
Yeah,
to being Michigan again, like to being a top five level program.
They need to beat Ohio State next year, and then they'll be officially back.
Yeah,
get two
in a row.
Yeah,
yeah. They at least just need to make the
you got to start splitting them up a little bit.
Yeah, like they can lose the next one, but if they win, like,
because it'd have been 8 years in a row.
God, that would have been frustrating. But as a Tennessee fan, I know that all too well.
Oh, also, wouldn't it have been so funny if Notre Dame it all shook out to where Notre Dame makes the playoff and Brian Kelly left?
I really wanted that to happen. That was the
that would have
I
been
really
so
wanted.
Funny.
That would have been awesome.
I wanted Notre Dame to. This is like secretly their best team ever. We just didn't even like they totally.
Me just, and my family.
He's such a faker,
dude. I don't like him. I think I sent y'all the story of him at Central Michigan.
Yeah, when he had his assistant coaches.
Robert Sala and Matt LaFleur.
Shoveling snow?
The best part about this, Brian Kelly, head coach at Central Michigan, still a jerk at this point. I guess he's been a jerk his whole life. His assistants are now NFL head coaches.
Yeah.
That's Matt LaFleur and Robert Sala.
That's insane.
I think that's what makes this story the best, is that it's two guys that are now NFL coaches.
I'm going to look up his coaching tree.
And so you have a Christmas party that Brian Kelly's having at his house. And he invites the staff, right? So LaFleur and Sala show up, and turns out they're not on the guest list. Well, what the heck? Like, we work for the guy. We're his assistants. How would we not be on the guest list? Turns out they're on the work list. So Brian Kelly had them valeting, like parking cars and shoveling snow, and then at the end of the night go get all the cars and bring them back, you know, while they shoveled snow the whole night. And then it said they went back to their apartment and stood around the table because they didn't have chairs because they weren't making anything or whatever. Like, are you kidding me? What a piece of trash to do that.
How do you treat your employees, and especially your employees, because basically they are his employees. He's their boss essentially. So I don't know how you just treat guys like that.
Yeah, and I think he's going to do pretty good at LSU, but now I am definitely cheering against him.
Yeah, I thought it was a good hire at first, and I still think it is a good hire, but now I'm going to be rooting. I agree with you there that I'm out on Brian Kelly, as a person at least.
Yeah, as a person.
As a person. I think he's a pretty good coach, so we'll see what happens there. But
oh, I also had one more thing talking about Heisman. Will, so this is – Will Anderson was in the Heisman talk like before this weekend because he's been an outstanding lineman for Alabama this year.
Yeah, he's good.
Obviously, Bryce Young probably elevated himself to that spot, and he's going to win it, I would think. But in 12 games this year – this is before they even played Georgia yesterday. 12 games, Will Anderson has 86 tackles, 50 of them solo. He has 30.5 tackles for loss, 14.5 sacks, and 4 pass breakups. So this graphic, they compared him to Joey Bosa, Aaron Donald, Ndamukong Suh, Chase Young, like some
is
of the past.
Is he a rush? Like, is he a defensive end?
Yeah, I think they play him kind of inside and outside.
Okay.
Yeah, he's an edge guy mostly. Yeah. Okay. But I mean, I think he'll line up in other spots. But I mean, Will, his numbers are better than your boy Ndamukong Suh.
Yeah, but slightly. He's a rush end.
That's true. But he has 30.5 tackles for loss, and Ndamukong Suh that dominant season he only had 20.5.
Right, but he's a defensive tackle. Like, that's the point. Like, I think that's the point. As defensive tackle, you're playing a position where you don't really, you're not supposed to necessarily fill the stat sheet.
Yeah.
Because you're a plug.
You're just supposed to eat blocks and stop the holes
or get out of the way for the linebacker to come in and blitz.
Yeah. You're literally supposed to take the double or triple team so the linebackers can come flying in and hit those holes.
Well, that's true. But
Anderson is awesome.
Yeah. Well, I'm not taking away anything from Anderson. He is a beast.
I really wouldn't have a problem with a defensive guy winning it now that I look at it this year, now that I really think about it. Just because no one else really impressed me. But I think I had heard Will Anderson's name mentioned, I feel like, in the past couple weeks. But I feel like for a defensive guy to win it, you got to be getting hype for a while.
You got to be dominating
the whole season. Because everyone knows who Bryce Young is. Everyone knows who CJ Stroud is.
Yeah, it's become a lot more of a clout game and social media game and who's the big name. Who wins the Heisman, really. And it's always the quarterback.
And like Anderson probably had a really good game.
Yeah.
The other day, but he wasn't like when Ndamukong Suh in the Big 12 championship,
when like, he had like
was the
four
game.
Or five sacks in that game or something.
Like he was the reason that game even was a game.
I just think it was interesting they compared him to these guys.
Yeah, his stats are ridiculous.
When Chase Young got invited to New York for the Heisman thing, and Will Anderson, besides having two less sacks than Chase Young, his numbers are better.
Do you know how many sacks does he have?
14.5.
Okay, because I think Hutchinson at Michigan has 14.
I think he has 13 or.
I think he got 14 this.
I don't know. But this was before yesterday. So his stats are better now since they played yesterday.
Cool to just have two defensive guys in New York.
That would be crazy.
You might
crazy
as well,
to see.
Like,
Said, there's not been.
Depends on how many guys they invite up there, because you have Young, Stroud. Is Corral still on the list?
I don't think so.
I would just put in Hutchinson and Anderson, throw them in there with Stroud and
That'd
Young.
That'd be
fun. Yeah.
Have two defensive guys there.
Yeah, two defensive linemen.
That'd be the first time ever, right? That defensive guys were invited to New York.
Maybe like way back in the day there were some, but yeah, as far as I know anyway.
Trying to think. I don't know.
We'll see. Any bowl games? We got a little shorter of an episode today, but we'll talk bowl games real quick. Any bowl games kind of stick out to y'all that you're excited to watch? Obviously, some of the New Year's Six bowls, maybe, or some of the...
Yeah, I was going to talk about this New Year's Six bowl, the Rose Bowl with Ohio State and Utah.
Oh, that'll be awesome.
I'm interested to keep following this Utah team.
Honestly,
how good are they going to be?
The Rose Bowl... Ohio State and Utah?
Yeah. That's going to be awesome.
The Rose Bowl is honestly my favorite bowl game. Ever since I watched DeAnthony Thomas in Oregon in that Rose Bowl against Wisconsin a long time ago, that's been my favorite game.
It is like the Rose
the
Bowl is
of them all.
Yeah, it's the granddaddy of them all.
I want to go to
loves the Rose Bowl.
I mean, I got to go to one.
Yeah, so I think that's on a lot of pretty much every maybe not every but most college football fans' bucket list. Yeah. You got to go see the Rose
Bowl. And they have a parade, the Rose Parade. That's cool. But yeah, no, that's definitely one I will be paying attention to.
I'm excited about.
Go through some of the other ones. Yeah. Oh, the Barstool Arizona Bowl, Boise State and Central Michigan.
Oh, that's going to be a huge one.
Chips up.
That'll be a good game.
Or Rise Up Chips or whatever
this is anymore, but I know Central Michigan's all right.
Another bowl I'll call out here we were talking about earlier, the Birmingham Bowl, that Houston-Auburn bowl game. I'm very interested to watch and see the results of that as well.
I don't know how well the Houston fans travel. And like I've been saying
certainly
all year,
not going to travel as well as Auburn fans to Birmingham.
Exactly. Like I've been saying all year, and I definitely do think the fans in the stadium make an impact, especially this year. They make an impact on the game, because obviously last year they weren't. I mean, some stadiums had capacity or
some didn't.
You know, limited capacity for fans. But this year, I think it's really played a big part in it. I don't know what the SEC championship game was like, if it was more Alabama or more Georgia, but
it probably was more Georgia in Atlanta, right?
Yeah, but when talking about the Birmingham Bowl, I would think Auburn gets an edge because they're expected to have more fans. Yeah, it's
definitely a home game for them compared to Houston's fans. Like, they're not going to travel all the way down to the Birmingham Bowl.
Well, and there can't be that many.
Yeah, I don't even know if I've ever met a Houston fan.
Dennis Quaid, apparently. He was on the commercial the other day. He was narrating it, and they showed him in the thing, and I was like, dude, that's awesome, because Dennis Quaid, like, probably on my list of top five, like, coolest guys ever.
He is pretty cool.
I always think he and the Dances with Wolves guy is, like, the same person.
Kevin Costner.
Yeah, they always, like, I always get him mixed up.
I could see that a little bit.
Yeah.
Yeah. But no, I think fans will make an impact, especially in the Birmingham Bowl.
And I feel
the Vols for the Music City Bowl.
Yes, that's the... I'll list off my top three. This is going to be my number three pick of bowl games I'm pointing out here, is Tennessee, Purdue, Music City Bowl is going to be electric.
Purdue?
Yes.
And former Giant Killer.
Yes. And I'm excited to fight or beat Purdue because of what they did to us in basketball when we had Grant Williams...
Ooh.
And that team in the Sweet 16, I have the poster right there. You can see Sweet 16 2019 lost to number 3 Purdue down there. I wrote in the tournament ones down there.
That's where they called the foul, right? And there was no foul.
There was no foul. And also, that was the game Carson Edwards was like, he hit the craziest three I've ever seen. Oh, that was such a frustrating game. But I think we were down 18 or 21 at one point in that game, came storming all the way back, brought it to OT, and then lost in OT.
So it's a Vols revenge game.
It is a big Vols revenge game. I hate Purdue right now, so they're number one on my kill list. I'm coming for you in the Music City Bowl. You Purdue fans better be scared, because I'm going to be loud.
I think that game will be fun, obviously. I mean, I'll go to that game just because it's here in Nashville, but also... I see three possibilities. I see it either just being a close game, or sorry, I should say, I guess, two possibilities, because I see it either being a close game either way, or I could see Tennessee winning this game by a few touchdowns, like the speed just being too much. Like, I'm not saying Purdue has a real chance to win, but I don't see Purdue, like, blowing Tennessee out, if that makes sense. I don't think they're going to be good enough to... They'll have to put up some points, and I just don't know if Purdue like puts up a lot of points, really. Like, no matter who they're playing, like, Tennessee's defense isn't great. It's gotten better. Purdue's kind of similar to Iowa, though, where they kind of try to control the clock. If it works, they kind of grind you out. And if that happens, yeah, Tennessee could be in trouble because they're not used to going slow. You know,
so yeah.
That's where, kind of similar to what Kentucky did to Tennessee earlier in the year, Tennessee would just score like right away, but then Kentucky would go on this long drive, tire out the defense, and then Tennessee would score right away, and their defense would have to be right back on the field, and it was just like a cycle, like, of a tired defense and like the offense being able to, like, Kentucky's offense being able to score on them. Mm-hmm. So maybe that's kind of that's probably Purdue's winning recipe, I would say, if that's what they're planning right now, that's what they should plan for.
The other game I'm interested in is Baylor Ole Miss.
I'm interested to see that too, because I mean, Baylor's got to be riding high right now. They're ready to go.
They're hot.
And Ole Miss is going to be hungry, because they're kind of, I feel like, they dipped a little bit and now they're on the upward trajectory again, so they're wanting to finish the
Lane
season
Kiffin
strong.
Got an extension.
Yeah, he got an extension. Pretty much everything got shut down that he's leaving, I think.
Yeah, and let's. I saw a bunch of Ole Miss fans, like, being like, oh, you guys are idiots for thinking he's going to ever leave. Okay.
Okay, what has he done his entire career?
Yeah, exactly. So don't act like...
Don't act like you can trust the guy all of a sudden, like...
They're only saying that because they were nervous that he might leave.
Yeah.
Yeah, exactly. Like, well, don't act like you're some college foot... Like, here's the thing, Ole Miss. I love Ole Miss. I love going to the Grove. Games are awesome. Everything. Like, Ole Miss is a great school in the SEC. It's fun. Everything. It's fun time. But hey, okay, Ole Miss, like, you're not Alabama. Like, coaches don't... You're not the epitome or, like, the mountaintop.
You're not on the Mount Rushmore of coaching jobs.
So, don't be surprised if a couple years down the road or whenever...
Kiffin goes to Bama after Saban retires.
Yeah, maybe.
When the Raiders hire him
after this year. The Raiders bring back Kiffin.
I mean, like, I think Kiffin kind of fits at Ole Miss because he's...
A jerk, frat, asshole. Respectfully, jeez,
man, fired off on the man.
Is there some?
I'm just mad because A&M lost to
Ole
Miss.
He's still a little hurt.
Okay, gotcha. Well, anyway.
Well, but Lane Kiffin is an asshole and a jerk. So
yeah, he kind of is.
Yeah, I can't.
Who is apparently afraid of heights. I saw a video of him walking around in the mall, and he didn't want to get close to the edge, and his son was trying to push him. He was scared of it.
That's pretty funny.
Yeah,
that is pretty funny.
Hey, buddy.
Old Joey Freshwater.
Yeah, but yeah, that'll be a good game. Baylor. Yeah. Baylor is now king of Big 12. So congratulations.
Shout out Dave Aranda, turning a program around in 2 years.
Yeah, bald head coach.
Something about it.
I don't know. We talked about somebody being bald. I think it was him.
Think we were talking about how bald head coaches are good.
Like pretty solid. Yeah, bald head coaches. Mm-hmm. Aranda, Franklin.
Is PJ Fleck bald?
Yep, PJ Fleck's bald.
Nick Saban's well on his way.
He's got to be
Rogaine watch. I agree.
Because there's a picture of him when he's at Michigan State and he's got gray hair.
Really?
Yeah, like 30 years ago.
I need to look that up.
God.
Oh, yeah, you can find it. Just be like, yeah, Nick Saban, gray hair.
Because that's the only real way to do it. You got to start coloring early. Because if you go from all gray to color, it's like, whoa.
You do the Drew Brees
hairline thing. Yeah, like what just happened here? So you got to – I like Saban getting in on it early and just coloring the whole time. That way he never goes gray, and it's never expected. So Saban did it the right way.
You'd think a guy like him, though, wouldn't really care.
He wouldn't care, yeah. He'd be like a guy like Belichick who will show up to press conferences in a hoodie with cut-off sleeves, and he just doesn't look professional at all, doesn't care about the answers, just all cares about winning. But, hey, maybe Saban is a little more vain than we thought.
Sorry about that phone. Anyway, yeah, maybe. Any other games stick up to y'all kind of as we wrap up?
Nothing's sticking out just yet, but I'm sure there's going to be some more storylines. And obviously, like Reese said, we still have 26 days until the bowls are played. So we'll get to be able to talk about some more of these games.
As they approach, especially we'll kind of be able to focus on probably a few leading up because, you know, they'll be staggered and everything. What you got?
Army-Navy game next weekend. It's my favorite game of the year. Respectfully.
Oh, yeah. We love our troops here.
I always get sad Army-Navy game because it means football's over.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I hope it snows. Do you think it's going to snow?
I'll look up the weather. I don't know. I hope it snows. It's a better game when it snows.
Oh, yeah. It's always a better
game. It's always a cool uniform game. Army-Navy have special uniforms this year.
They'll have the American flag uniforms.
Apparently, Army's offensive coordinator is in that. He's one of the rumors for the new Nebraska offensive coordinator job.
Oh. Which I don't think Nebraska's going to run triple option.
Well, we ran the option some this year, so it's like, okay, is that what you're doing? I don't know if that's really what I want to do necessarily.
And so one coaching piece that we forgot to cover here was Venables to Oklahoma.
Is it official?
Yeah. I don't even know. I don't know if the official details of the deal have come out, but it's pretty much done. I know. So, and I think he's taken Ole Miss's current OC, or at least that's his target. Bringing him along.
And did you see today Joe Brady got fired from the Panthers?
He did.
So he might make a return to college.
Nebraska coordinator. That, we need him.
I mean,
if we got, so the Huskers, they hired Mickey Joseph, the LSU receivers coach. Yeah. He decided he didn't want to work with Kelly, so he's back. He played quarterback in Nebraska.
Oh, man, that's a great hire.
Hey, Justin Jefferson, Ja'Marr Chase, ever heard of him?
Yeah. that are lighting up the NFL right
now? One of them apparently was a two-star. I think it was Jefferson was a two-star.
Was he really?
It was one or the other, yeah.
Hey, yeah. Sometimes the rankings are wrong.
You turn, or maybe Mickey Joseph is just that
good. Yeah, maybe he's that good.
It's not looking like we're going to get snow, guys, for the Army-Navy game. Although, 50% precipitation, so it could be a rain game.
Hmm.
That'd be cool. A muddy option game.
Ooh, I'd like
game.
That. Yeah. Little army crawl.
The low crawl.
Army crawl in the mud.
Yeah. All right, guys. Well, that was big. Thanks for listening.
A lot of college football.
Yeah, a lot of college football talk. Glad we were able to get this going in.
We'll cover NFL more next week we'll have our schedules back in order again. It was like a bye week for Pater.
Kind of having to do this on a Sunday night, but we had other, you know, right as of right now, this doesn't pay the bills. So if you want to, be sure to talk to your buddies and let them come be sponsors on the show, and we'll be happy to put all of our time and attention into this podcast.
Yeah,
100%.
Except for Reese, because he's a troop. So
yeah,
that's right.
Serving the country. But anyway.
Yeah, okay. Titans didn't play. We didn't care about the NFL this week.
Yeah.
Still some games going on.
We'll get going on. Guys, if you haven't noticed either, we've also partnered up with Six Pack Coverage.
Let's go. Huge news.
Shout out Six Pack Coverage. We're really pumped to be kind of going forward with them. Go ahead. Check out their website as well.
We'll post about it.
Yeah, we'll definitely post about it. Check out their website. They have stuff, not just sports, but all kinds of media. They're based out here in Nashville. They've got stuff on food, media, fitness,
everything.
Sports, everything you can think of. So be sure to go check them out, sixpackcoverage.com. Be sure to check out our website, paterdsports.blog, and be sure to follow us on Twitter, patered_sports, or on Instagram, paterdsports. And yeah, lots of content coming. We're growing. We keep going.
We had
one of our highest listened to pods last week, so thanks for that, guys. We appreciate you. And we'll see y'all next week.
See you next week. Pay dirt out.
It's Hell Week for Caterpillar. Get hype.
Woo!